Mr. Jaivir Singh, thank you for speaking with the CSR Journal. At the outset, tell me the brief themes around which PwC Foundation works.
Firstly, thank you for having me. And I think the PwC India Foundation, which was founded about 10 years ago, we have our core areas of focus are around environmental sustainability and education. But what we found was that basis the relevance of what India's needs are, we needed to drill those down to be somewhat more specific over certain periods of time. So if you look at our core areas of focus, they're really speaking five, which is environmental sustainability, water and sanitation, education slash skill, okay. Urban children, and humanitarian response programs. Okay. So, and if you look at those, subjects, they're essentially based on what the primary needs of the Indian sort of public are. Just to sort of go one step deeper into those, you know, there's lots of talk around water and sanitation. We have the Swachh Bharat campaign, today, which is pushed a great deal by the government. But what we said was that just rather than looking at the entire wash piece, we would drill it down to actually concentrating on a particular element. So some years ago, along with Save the Children in India, we did a fairly substantive report around urban children and the issues of urban children. Now, why urban children, you would ask?
Yes, and what are the issues that you came across?
Sure, and why urban children is because India has one of the largest urbanization rates.
Correct.
If you look at when the new government came into power, there was a huge thrust around smart cities.
Correct.
If you mix those with the type of services that a PwC professional services sector provides, we're probably one of the larger advisors to the government on the smart city program. So here there was an issue which was a development related issue, but where we had great amounts of competence as well. And we said that, you know, maybe considering urban children in terms of a specific area of focus had not been looked at previously, we engaged with Save the Children to come out with a very, very deep report. Which then threw out a bunch of suggestions.
So what did it what did you come across? What are the issues that they are facing?
So one of, and the reason why I started with that was because if you look at our water and sanitation programs, they're very focused around peri-urban and urban girls' government schools.
All right.
So much has been talked about in terms of dropout rates, in terms of less attendance, especially at a critical time in a young lady's life.
Correct.
And we said, can we focus on that particular space and not sort of go across the board in the water and sanitation? So if you look at a lot of our programs, especially for the last 3 years, whether it's in Rajasthan, whether it's in Hyderabad, whether it's the one that I'm recently coming from in Pali district as well, they're very, very focused around being able to create appropriate water and sanitation and hygiene facilities for girls in government schools.
How do you work out an exit policy in projects like this so as to move forward and expand accordingly?
Sure. So I think, you know, it's a very, very good question because I think one of the challenges in the private sector has been that we do sometimes parachute development.
Correct.
That means we come, we tick the box and then we leave.
Correct.
We've tried to, in terms of the type of programs and the type of subject that you're addressing, we've tried to in some way be able to do it somewhat better perhaps.
Right.
So whilst we're not the ones who actually deploy on ground, it's our NGO partners who will deploy on ground, we keep a very, very strong oversight mechanism. So monitoring and evaluation frameworks are created.
Okay.
There's first a baseline assessment which is done. We then monitor and evaluate the program.
Mm.
At particular intervals, we'll actually go back along with our NGO partners and say, okay, do we need to course correct somewhere? We do those course corrections. And then for longer term sustainability, we actually hope to change the behaviors of the institutions that we work with.
Okay.
So one such example, let me give you in the context of Ajmer, we actually, after running the program there for a year, we had some young ladies come to us and tell us that they had forced their parents to build toilets in their own homes.
That's lovely.
So to us, real change is when that begins to happen, because then children who are great ambassadors in the home setting become the ones who are really speaking at the forefront of that mission.
And are the future of tomorrow in that sense.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
So you mentioned that PwC has been doing work for the last 10 years.
Yes.
The mandate came only very recently. What do you think about the government making social work mandatory?
You're talking about the 2% CSR rule?
That's right.
I actually think it's a step in the right direction. Let me go back a few steps first, because if you look at the Indian culture as a whole, we've had a great sense of giving.
Correct.
Over many, many sort of thousands of years.
But the problem has always been hereditary philanthropy. We always save for our grandsons and their kids accordingly.
Yep.
Or we give it to religious trusts, etc.
You've hit the nail on the head. So imagine if we lived in a world where, let's say, half of what of the monies that go to sort of religious centers, who, by the way, also use it for development purposes.
Absolutely.
But if it was to be used far more efficiently and targeted towards some of India's most fundamental challenges, yes, you would have massive change. If you look at the private sector's involvement, I think, you know, one of the things that society has done over a period of time is, whenever we talk about development or infrastructure creation, we always point the finger at either government or we point it at the development sector.
Correct.
Whereas I think quite apart from just money, the private sector has a lot to offer. And if you look at a lot of our pro bono related programs or the oversight mechanisms that I spoke of earlier, those are really speaking driven by people within PwC. And that's not just within the foundation, but from the larger firm as well.
Okay.
Because one of the benefits that we have in the professional services industry is we have access to a very wide range and a very deep range of services, right, and skill sets, which then allows us to be able to get great minds working to solve some of our most fundamental challenges. So I think just to go back to your question, I think it's a step in the right direction. Do we have a long way to go in terms of that compliance actually coming through and people actually spending that money and being efficient at spending that money? I think we have some distance to go.
Okay.
But I think kudos to the policymakers in some ways to force this towards the private sector, because I think while some institutions, and you know, you have some great institutions in Bombay, for example, and families in Bombay who've been doing development for many, many decades.
Sure.
I think that needed to be far more broad-based than it was previously.
Okay.
So I think it's a step in the right direction. Does it need to be fine-tuned? Do we need to get better at being able to monitor it, evaluate it, assess it? Yes, we do. But you know, I'm sure you have the numbers around.
Do we also need a monitoring body in place to make sure they're complying, because there are penalties also being served?
Absolutely.
They're not following in line. Do you think we need a monitoring body also there?
I think so. The question to ask would be that who would really speaking be the owner of that within government, because an institution...
Ministry of Corporate Affairs?
A parallel institution does not exist. So on the compliance side, when you talk about the financing of it, MCA is
Correct.
The one which is at the forefront.
Correct.
So you would have heard of the number of over 1,000 companies which were non-compliant last year. So yes, the MCA will play a part in terms of the financial contribution side of it, but when you actually look at whether the programs are making societal development happen in the way that you want it to happen, that competency may sit somewhere else. So typically, if you were to look at the Women and Child Ministry, for example, on programs related to girl education, right, they would probably be far better placed in terms of the skill sets required to be able to assess a girl-child related program, because that's what they do. So yes, I think, does government need to create a mechanism where it's assessing programs outside of just financial contribution?
It's required.
Absolutely. And I think, again, that's a space where the private sector could play a very, very deep role.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. It's great that you go to the last detail at the last mile.
Yes.
A lot of corporates are also doing their bit, but having the kind of demographic that our country has, I think working in collaboration would make a difference. Do you think that needs to be addressed amongst corporates? Because each one is working in silos. Each foundation is doing their own work. They're associating with the NGOs on ground. But then collaboration will make the larger difference which our demographic needs to see. What do you think about the same?
You know, again, I think for too long have we said that the private sector does not perhaps even at the first instant need to be participative in some of the issues that we're looking at now.
Okay.
So, I think the first step of that is actually getting them sensitized and closer to the subjects that we want to address.
Okay.
So I think we're a little early in that game at the moment. Do you have match funding based partnerships which are happening today? They are. But I think the far more important collaboration that needs to happen is really speaking building the capacities of small and medium-sized NGOs in India, which the private sector could have a huge role to play in terms of expanding that capacity, expanding their skill sets and their sort of geographic footprint. So I think, to me, in the first instance, private sector efficiencies, private sector competency to help the medium-sized and small institutions who work in development at the grassroots level, that conversation and that narrative needs to be one that needs to be taken to the next level.
Sure.
I think it's post that you can look at cross private sector collaboration, which, by the way, is already happening.
Yeah.
So you do have programs where there are institutions who come from even different sectors who are coming together to address, in a particular geography, a particular type of issue.
Okay. So we have a couple of the first few countries who have the mandate in CSR.
Correct.
Eventually, a lot of other countries, not necessarily taking the cue from us, but eventually a lot of other countries across the globe have made CSR mandatory in one way or the other. Touching about the humanitarian issues that are there globally, I would like to know a little more about the Rohingya cases that you all have been addressing.
Oh, okay. So I think Rohingya is not, the Rohingya programs are not ones that are really speaking driven by the India Foundation.
Okay.
They're driven by our global network,
okay,
which is based out of the UK.
But that's again the corporate responsibility angle of it.
Absolutely, okay. Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
If you could tell me a little about that.
So sure, I mean, if you look at, if you look at humanitarian related emergencies, and let me just stay with the man-made and the natural disaster related ones. I mean, in 1718 versus 1617 there were twice as many. So the complexity and the frequency by which we're being we're having to face natural disasters is far more than it has ever been, and you mix that with the fact that you have increased densities in cities, you have far more pressure on resources. This is not going to go away. You mix that with the idea that you've got, you know, political dynamics, you've got conflict in different parts of the world, and to be specific about the Rohingya issue, I think you had a large influx into a country like Bangladesh,
correct,
which in many ways was not prepared for it.
Yes.
And just the pace at which the movement happened. So I was in the camps in late November, early December, which is about 1.5 to 2 months after the first influx started. So you're talking about 400,000 people moving within 3 months. Now just imagine what happens to a country like Bangladesh, or any country for that matter, when you have to, or host communities especially, when you have to deal with such a large influx of people,
coming
from the history that they're coming from, with pretty much nothing but what they can carry in their hands. So I think it's about being able to address some of the larger issues in the world, because PwC as an institution globally has the ability to do that, because of the size and scale of the operations that we have. But I think to be specific in the Rohingya case as well, we had the early part of when I went, we actually went and did a need assessment, which is how we plan all of our humanitarian programs. So if it's, whether it's a drought mitigation program that we're currently running in Bundelkhand, which is in the UP, or if you look at some of the programs that we've had in Nepal post the earthquake, it's very, very need-based. So we don't do it just to tick the box. We actually send our own people there, and that's really speaking myself. We do a need assessment in terms of what are the priority needs in the region. We mix that then with what is it that the PwC type system can bring to the table. And then we find appropriate institutions on ground who have the same sort of mental model as we do in terms of those priorities. So if you look at the highest priorities, if you look at any of the situation reports from the development agencies in Bangladesh, it's really speaking water and sanitation and health, considering the type of weather that is upon us in Bombay, as well as in Bangladesh and Cox's Bazar. So I think we concentrated on being able to provide healthcare infrastructure to one of the small-sized NGOs which were already operating in the region, local Bangladeshi NGO. Again, let me go back to my original comment that I made to you. We take somewhat more risks than some of the other private sector in terms of being able to go and engage with smaller and medium-sized institutions, because the risk levels, the competency levels in those competencies are lower, risk levels are somewhat higher. But we also do that because that's where the need lies, right? Because if we don't capacity expand the skill sets in those institutions with additional resources and assistance, you're not creating a sustainable model for the future. That means you will perpetually be looking at the parachute development model, which I'm not so sure is appropriate as you look at a constrained resource dynamic in the development space in the future.
Okay. In our country, after the mandate came around, there were certain parameters that was part of the schedule which were mentioned. So there have been sectors like sports and animal welfare that haven't been receiving equal attention. I know it's human first, I do understand that bit, but that it's equal in every way. So the problem is they aren't receiving enough funds. I understand education, health, sanitation need to be there, the basics need to be there, but what can we do to address these sectors too?
So I think without going into a blame game on this, I would tend to agree with the second comment that you made. I think the first port of call, because in some ways perhaps the private sector was late in terms of being able to come into this game. I think the priorities in the early years, and it's been fairly recent, I mean, this 2% CSR rule came in 5 or 6 years ago. So I think in the early stages, what you will find is a selection of priorities, right? Yeah. And in that selection of priorities, I do find it somewhat of I'm an animal lover. I spent a fair amount of my time working in with the World Wildlife Fund in outside of India, actually. So it's about setting priorities. I think today what you will find is that the human condition will attract far more priority status
as compared to
some of the others. Animal welfare or sport
for that matter.
And you know, we mustn't look at sport just in the context of the playing of the sport and getting better in terms of international rankings. Sport has many other things that it brings to the table in terms of human development.
Absolutely.
But again, is that a priority from a life-saving perspective?
I'm not so sure.
So I think the private sector and the development sector and the government will look at some of those more life-saving and other priority sectors, health and education and such like, before we actually get to that point where the mental conscience of the larger society will move to some of these other subjects.
Okay, fair enough. We usually as corporates tend to do activities which are close by in the perimeter, so we do something that's close by our areas. That kind of creates a downside for, say, a place like the Northeast, where people don't go over there and address the development needs over there. What do you think of the same?
It's very interesting. You mentioned the Northeast. It's a priority region for us, has been for the last 2 years.
All right.
So, and again, it's based on the principle. We split it in two ways. We have offices in 8 locations in India.
Okay.
But if you look, and therefore that's where our people work. So if we look at a lot of the volunteering that happens, you need to have programs which are close to your office. Right, and
yeah.
That's just purely because of the logistics and the efficiency that causes. Having said that, if you look at some of our other programs, I mean, I'm talking from Bundelkhand to Manipur to Assam to Pulwama in Srinagar.
Okay.
Well, not in Srinagar, in Kashmir, which is one of the hardest places. There's no private sector there. Post the flood in JNK 4 or 5 years ago, we actually went out and built a school in Tral in Pulwama, which is not the safest place to work. But I think part of the reason that we did that was because that's where the most substantive need existed.
Correct. Do you always face support, and are they always welcoming, or do you face resistance also from them? Because they're very skeptical, the people on fail.
Yeah.
They're very skeptical about the corporates coming in and doing something they probably still don't know of. So do you always get support, or do you face resistance?
You know, it's very interesting you say this, because one of the things that I try to spend a lot of my time on is to increase the level of conversations between institutions like us and the development sector.
Okay.
Because I think there is, you know, you've hit the nail on the head. I think there is a general sense of mistrust because of the type of transactional conversations that would typically happen between the development sector and the private sector, which is why if you look at, again, some of our programs, we try to be as close to our partners on ground and do programs with them so that the trust deficit perhaps that has existed historically lessens.
True.
And it's all about context. If I understand your challenges on ground, you understand mine in where I work.
Find a midway to come together.
Yeah, and that narrative will change. Are there still challenges with dealing with small and medium-sized institutions?
Yeah.
Of course there are. But that's the challenge related to change. And it's one that you need to go through if you really want to create sustainable models for the future.
And day in, day out, we have to go through it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. But if it wasn't hard, it wouldn't be fun, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Tell me a little about your experience of being on field in all the places that you visited, interacted with the people, something that's probably close to your heart and changed something for you personally, maybe?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I must say, I'm deeply moved by some of the resilience that I see in communities which have been through so much. So, you know, and to me, my real expertise is in the humanitarian response space, and been doing very frontline volunteering in that space for the last 10 years, but formerly with PwC for the last 4. But I think it changes you. I think just being out of the context of what we're used to changes us as human beings. And many people ask me why I work in this space. And the interesting thing is that there was a flip moment, when there was this context that got presented in front of you, where you really speaking saw humanity at its worst, but also at its best. And that sort of fundamentally changes you in some ways. So my heart, by the way, lies far more in the field than it does in the office.
Any specific anecdotes?
But I do recognize that it's the marrying of the field and where we sit today in terms of where the resources are. That marriage needs to happen, because without that marriage, you'll have silos working.
Correct.
Which I'm not sure is the best way to be able to address those needs.
I completely agree with you. Yeah. Any anecdotes that's close to your heart, maybe an incident, maybe?
Yeah, I mean, I spent a night in one of our shelters that we built in Gorkha in Nepal some years ago, and just to be, again, like I said, just to be around some of these people who will share with you when they have very little themselves. Is that beauty in the humanity context?
The humility part of it,
absolutely.
And it's very heart touching.
Absolutely,
yes.
Absolutely. And I again had the fortune early in my life to spend a lot of time on farms, actual farms. So have had some of that exposure. But again, like I said, it doesn't matter which part of India or which part of the world you go to. The type of giving that happens at that grassroots level, because you come into that situation with an intent to help. If that intent is true, it's amazing the type of responsiveness that you get from local communities.
Because they connect and pick up on the vibes, so
absolutely.
They respond accordingly.
Absolutely.
Okay. Could you tell me very briefly what is CSR to you?
To me, it's. I think it's. It should be embedded within the human condition, right? I go back to that idea of saying innately, I think all human beings are good.
Okay.
But I think sometimes we get. We get too bogged down by the realities around us, whether it be work or family or such like. And I think CSR is not just about being able to go out and do big programs in places which have very, very high needs, right? The classic point is that, we sit in an office of where we do at the moment. Can we at least look at maintaining the 10 meters outside of our office walls?
True.
If you start with that sort of individual conscience, it's amazing the type of change that you can cause. So I think the real one needs to start with yourself, with home, and with your neighbors. And if a billion, if more than a billion people can make that happen, I can tell you our country would look very different.
Yes, so we have this whole motivation and we have all the stakeholders present. How can we actually bring them all together to, actually transform things on field and for the nation at large?
Civil society has a huge role to play. So I think I think if you look at the government and if you look at the development sector, and if you look at the private sector, those conversations have begun to happen, as I mentioned.
Correct, yes.
Because today we're in a far more resource-constrained world than we used to be 30 years ago, 40 years ago. So today people are actually having some of those conversations to say, okay, can I become far more efficient at what I do versus bringing a shelter which is from the other part of India into providing a solution in Nepal?
True.
Can I look at something locally in Nepal?
True.
So those type of conversations to make the system far more efficient have begun to happen. But I think civil society institutions have a huge role to play.
Absolutely.
And again, individuals have a huge, huge role to play. So I think a large onus lies with leadership.
Absolutely.
And if you have some of the leaders doing it, you'll find a lot of change happening at the mid and the lower levels.
It all trickles down eventually.
Absolutely.
Okay. It's been absolutely lovely talking to you. Thank you for your time and speaking with the CSR Journal.
My pleasure, and thank you very much for having me.
Thank you.